The right hand that many call the hardest single punch ever thrown. Muhammad Ali was still Cassius Clay when he dazzled the world with a stunning upset of Sonny Liston. And after Ali, Larry Holmes was recognized as the legitimate champion. But in recent years, three different organizations, the World Boxing Association, the World Boxing Council, and the International Boxing Federation, sanctioned championship fights, and each claimed that their man was the real title holder. One of the most prestigious titles in sports had been cheapened by a confusing series of unknown champions. The heavyweight division was a mess. Then 2 years ago, a young bull named Mike Tyson began an all-out assault that made him the youngest heavyweight champion ever and earned him the WBC and the WBA versions of the title. In 1985, the third title was taken from Larry Holmes by Michael Spinks, first light heavyweight champion to win even a share of the heavyweight crown. The two Michaels, Tyson and Spinks, were scheduled to settle matters with a unification fight last month. But Spinks pulled out and was stripped of his title, leaving Mike Tyson to defend against former champion Pinklon Thomas. While Michael Spinks took on Jerry Cooney last week before a sellout crowd in Atlantic City. Tonight, we'll talk with the winner. And for the first time on network television, you'll see both fights and examine the question, who is the heavyweight champion of the world? The heavyweight showdown. Michael Spinks versus Jerry Cooney, the fight which took place June 15 in Atlantic City. And Mike Tyson versus Pinklon Thomas, May 30 in Las Vegas. Question are the two men who sit at the center of that question. On the right, Mike Tyson, current holder of the WBA and WBC versions of the heavyweight title, a man with a chance on August 1 to unify the championship in the eyes of all three existing governing bodies if he can defeat current IBF title holder Tony Tucker. And on the left, the man who twice defeated Larry Holmes, who was seen at the time as the legitimate heavyweight champion of the world, Michael Spinks, a man who, though stripped of that title by the International Boxing Federation, is still seen in many circles as the legitimate heavyweight champion. Also joining me for this discussion, in the ring, our ABC Sports boxing expert, Alex Wallow. And Alex, we're going to look first at Tyson Thomas.
Indeed we are, Jim. As Mike Tyson has moved up the heavyweight ladder, we've seen evidence of a kind of split personality. And his first two world title fights were really dramatic evidence of his two extremes. In November of last year, he looked sensational when he went up against WBC champion Trevor Burbick, who chose to stand and fight with Michael and got bombed out early by the Tyson power. This was the victory that made Mike the youngest heavyweight champion in boxing history. Then in March, he looked lethargic against WBA champion James Bone Crusher Smith, who did nothing but grab and hold for 12 of the dullest rounds in heavyweight championship history. Mike fought just enough to win every round, but it was an embarrassing effort for a young man who says he feels an obligation not just to win, but to create excitement in the ring. And Mike, coming off the Smith performance, were you determined to look impressive against Thomas?
Well, at that particular time, I felt like Mr. Smith didn't want to do anything but win, you know, last the 12 rounds, and I knew Pinklon Thomas came to win back his title, and I felt very confident in a spectacular performance.
Mike's opponent in his third title fight last month was Pinklon Thomas, a man once considered the heir apparent to Larry Holmes as the dominant heavyweight in the world. He was unbeaten in 25 fights when he stepped in against Tim Witherspoon in August of 1984 and used his outstanding left jab to dominate the fight and capture the title. Pinklon Thomas showed he had more than just a jab when he went against former champion Mike Weaver and destroyed Weaver with a single right hand. But the bright lights distracted Pinklon Thomas, and he was very unimpressive in losing his WBC title in March of 86 to Trevor Burbick. It was that title that Mike Tyson won from Burbick, and it was that title, along with the WBA version of the heavyweight championship, that were on the line as Mike Tyson, unbeaten in 29 fights with 26 knockouts, defended against Pinklon Thomas last month in Las Vegas.
The third man in the ring, veteran referee Carlos Padilla.
And right off the bat, Mike Tyson threw a power punch with the right hand, and right away, Pinklon Thomas tied him up. And again, Thomas, making sure Tyson doesn't do any damage inside.
Tyson, of course, had been frustrated in two previous bouts, the one immediately preceding this one when Bone Crusher Smith tied him up inside, locking his arms down. And Mitch Green had done it the year before in a bout in Madison Square Garden.
Low right hand below Thomas's belt, and Mike Tyson was warned by referee Padilla.
Certainly it appeared here in round one, Alex, after that good right-left combination, that Tyson was determined to get off to the kind of fast start he had exhibited in his title-winning two-round TKO of Trevor Burbank.
The important thing is he put punches together. There he tried a jab, missed it, tried another one, connected, and then came with another punch. And there, two good body punches. When Mike Tyson is at his best, he is a devastating body puncher.
Good left hook, driving Thomas back into the ropes.
And right after that left hook, when Thomas was on the ropes, a right hand to the body, and then in combination, a left hook to the head. Pinklon Thomas tried to fight back. He didn't run. He's not grabbing at this point. Maybe it's just that Tyson's just too active. He's just throwing too many punches. And too strong inside.
And now just past the midway point of round one, the crowd at ringside began to anticipate a possible early knockout as Thomas's legs appeared a bit wobbly.
The biggest surprise of this round was the fact that Pinklon did not move more. Angelo Dundee, his trainer, said he was going to show Tyson a lot of lateral movement and confuse him. But here in round one, he just hasn't been able to do so.
It was also interesting that he was unable to tie Tyson up inside and force him to stop punching, as had Smith and Green for long occasions. There, a devastating left hook. And again, Thomas backed up against the ropes.
Two tremendous punches inside, led by the uppercut. Mike Tyson at this point is really fighting left-handed. He's got his right foot forward. He's looking to load up that left hand. He just missed it there. The right uppercut inside. Thomas not holding on here. Perhaps 2 days to do so.
So largely as the result of the effectiveness of the left hook used over and over again, round one was a devastating and overpowering round for the champion, Mike Tyson.
13 years old, and he's watching me box. And the only thing I can remember him saying was that you're going to be the youngest heavyweight champion in the world.
Lockdown rounds, drag out fights, endless days and sleepless nights, and one memory that still shines bright. You were there for me.
I miss you, Cuz.
Okay.
Round two, the round in which Mike Tyson had finished off Trevor Burbick after a similarly dominant round one to take away a title that Burbick had won from this same Pinklon Thomas 6 months before.
Mike missed two left hooks and then the right hand. A little bit of movement here from Pinklon to start of round two.
And you had to suspect that Thomas's concerns entering round two would be, number one, to move and try to stay away from some of Tyson's heavy punches, and two, to begin to try to tie him up a little bit inside.
And the surprising thing here, Mike was not as active on the inside as he could have been. You see his hands are free there. He did not let his hands go with the kind of powerful shots that he did in round one. A good Tyson jab. That's a jab that he shows all the time in the gym, but he has not yet been able to work into his fight plan in the ring.
Good body punches again from Tyson. And this time, Thomas began to clinch and hold. But now Pinklon Thomas was looking for his opportunities to throw the left jab.
Not hard punches, but a little bit annoying, a little bit distracting for Tyson. And again, the two fighters laying on each other on the inside at the halfway mark in round two. In
Round one, Tyson would not have stood there and just pawed with his punches. He was ripping punches then. You heard Kevin Rooney's voice maybe in the background. Push him off, step back. It looked like Mike's near the crowd beginning to boo. It looked like Mike was thinking about pushing back, and a good isolated left hook.
Early boos from the crowd in that brief period of inactivity, but of course, this was the scene of the disappointing Bone Crusher Smith bout. Tyson there seemed determined not to let it happen again.
But at the end of that combination, he looked amateurish. His opponent was out of range, and Mike let go a wild right hand. Falling inside. Mike Tyson is not working his way in behind the jab or not letting his hands go. He kind of falls inside and does not let his hands go.
And as round two came to a close, the fight had taken on an entirely different complexion than at the end of round one. It no longer appeared that Tyson was headed for an easy early knockout. Questions had arisen.
Mike, what caused the change in your fighting style from round one when you're so aggressive and dominant to the latter stages of round two?
Well, you see, after I exerted the energy in round one, I saw every time I hit him with a punch, I was able to hurt him. And then I wasn't concentrating. I just take him out. I knew any time I hit him, I could hurt him. And I wasn't really conscious of just going any amount of rounds. And I just knew eventually he would tire, as I saw in his last couple of fights, and I would catch him and he would go.
Were you trying to pace yourself? Were you afraid of running out of gas?
No, not at all. It's just that because I can box 15, 20 rounds, it's just that I was cautious of the heat and, you know, over expiring from the heat. So I just wanted to take my time just trying to land a shot and get him out there and get him hurt and finish him.
Well, the action stayed much the same in rounds 3, 4, and 5. Mike doing enough to win on most of the judges' scorecards. Thomas Jab giving a little bit of trouble. We'll be back in a moment and pick up the action with round 6.
So as round 6 began, Tyson chased Pinklon Thomas to the ropes and was immediately grabbed for his trouble.
Step up. Okay, hold it, hold it. Bring it up, bring it up, bring it up. Hold your punches. Step up.
Now the burden was falling on referee Carlos Padilla to be more active in controlling the bout.
There you saw Mike try to step back and get punching room, but he didn't let his hands go.
It was a good idea, though. The kind of thing that Kevin Rooney urges Tyson to do.
There are two good punches, both to the body. The body punches obviously do two things. They take the opponent's legs away, and they should create punching opportunities to the head.
It was body punching which had established the tempo in round one when Tyson appeared to be close to knocking Thomas out. Now, he tried to take command of the bout with a similar assault. The right uppercut landed on Thomas's chin.
And that turned the crowd's booing, which had just begun, into cheers. Again, Kevin Rooney from the Tyson corner. Punch out, punch out.
And there, the savage left hook.
And that punch really was the beginning of the end.
And now this flurry of blows, dominated by the left hook. Three of them right there, putting Thomas on the canvas. Padilla finished the count. Angelo Dundee entered the ring to say that his fighter should take no more punishment. That was it.
Mike, did that fight answer any questions you had about yourself?
No, there was never no doubts. There were never no doubts in my quality or capabilities and confidence in handling anyone in the world. It's just that I wanted to have a good, spectacular performance in this fight prior to the fight 6 weeks ago, before that. And I was pretty satisfied. I put punches together and I knew I had to take him out in the sixth round, and every punch was throwing in bad intentions. And once I got him hurt, you know, he shouldn't even blink or twitch. And once I found out, I just put it all out, and that was it.
Well, let's take a look back at the crucial punches in that sixth round that led to the first stoppage of Pinklon Thomas in his professional career.
And right now, I'm sitting, I'm throwing my jab, and I'm leaning to my left where I'm going to throw the hook, because I knew he was going to drop his hand, his right as soon as he jabs. And right there, he was in a tremendous amount of pain.
You got underneath his jab to throw that left hook. A lot of people said that his jab gave you trouble. Is that accurate?
No, not at all. But as you know, he had the best left hand in the business, and he could give anyone problems, but I refused to be denied. And after I saw I had him hurt, I just put everything together. And the punches he was taking was tremendous. Even though he seems like he's incoherent at the moment, he's able to get away from some of the punches, but they were just coming in such a concession. Oh, and he was so brave, man. He took those punches. Any lesser guy would probably stay down for the first left hook.
Left hook was dominant in that flurry. Let's take a look at your right uppercut here from the overhead view.
As you see, the uppercut was effective, but it wasn't accurate enough. I just barely grazed him with the end of my thumb.
Another angle on the sequence of punches that led to the stoppage. Do you have any criticisms of this performance at all, Mike? Anything you want to go back into the gym and try to learn?
Well, not at all. You know, I let him feel comfortable that he can hold me. But which really, if you really put it to perspective, I could have got out of any one of his clinches. I mean, he felt comfortable, safe, so he stayed safe.
Well, of course, an interested spectator here in the ring as we look back at that replay of Tyson Thomas, excuse me, is the man in the tuxedo with the bandage on his eye, Michael Spinks. Your reaction to that fight, Michael?
Well, I thought it was a good fight for Tyson, and I still didn't understand why the public was booing the way they were, but I think he displayed a very powerful performance.
Now, as you look at a fight like that, in your present state of affairs, do you look at it as purely an interested spectator or as a scout looking ahead?
I look at it as an interesting spectator.
All right, there'll be plenty of time to prepare for Mike Tyson when that fight comes up. And of course, when we come back right after this, we're going to get to the business of Michael Spinks and Jerry Cooney. Back to our ring in our ABC Sports studios in New York, and prepare now to look back at the fight which was billed as the War at the Shore. Michael Spinks versus Jerry Cooney. As he prepared for this fight, Michael Spinks was unbeaten in 27 fights as a light heavyweight and 3 as a heavyweight. Michael Spinks first entered the public eye as middleweight gold medalist at the 1976 Olympics, then won his first 15 pro fights before stepping into the ring in March 1981 against former light heavyweight champion Marvin Johnson. With one punch in the fourth round, he catapulted himself into a title shot against WBA light heavyweight champion Eddie Mustafa Muhammad. This was a grueling fight for the first 11 rounds, but a combination in round 12 dropped the champion, and Spinks went on to capture a unanimous decision and the title. He then scored KOs in his first 5 title defenses, but the match the public demanded and got took place in March of 1983 between Spinks and then WBC champion Dwight Muhammad Kawi. Here, he used reach, hand speed, and above all, an accurate left jab to unify the light heavy crown. 2 years later, he moved up to challenge IBF heavyweight titleist Larry Holmes. And at the end of 15 chaotic rounds, Michael Spinks awaited the decision of the judges in Las Vegas.
For the winner, by unanimous decision, and new IBF heavyweight champion of the world, Michael Spinks.
Become the first light heavyweight champion in history to move up and capture a heavyweight crown. After retaining the IBF title in a controversial rematch with Holmes, Michael stopped Norwegian Stefan Tangstad in the fourth round in his last fight, thus setting up the match with Jerry Cooney. So Spinks arrived at June 15 with an 11-year pattern of unbroken success, and the same was true up to a point of Jerry Cooney. But Cooney's career has been an unusual one, in some ways more graphically defined by his one loss than by his 28 victories. Jerry Cooney waded through his first 24 professional opponents with 20 knockouts before stepping in against former champion Ken Norton in May 1981. 54 brutal seconds into round one, it was all over for Norton. 13 months passed, before the much ballyhooed battle between Cooney and WBC champion Larry Holmes, a fight in which Jerry started well, then seemed too preoccupied by the longer championship distance and didn't fight his fight. By the 13th round, an exhausted and battered Cooney was finished. He fell into a period of deep personal depression, quit the ring, tried a short live comeback, then quit the ring again, citing personal problems, before finally coming back once more, May 1986, against the lightly regarded Eddie Gregg, and demonstrating, at least that at this level of competition, the old punching power was still there. The 86-second demolition of Gregg made Cooney a marketable contender again. Though in 5 years, he had spent fewer than 7 rounds in the ring without headgear, and none of that against a strong opponent.
Mike, this was your 4th fight as a heavyweight, but your first against a man with a reputation as a big puncher. Did you prepare in any special way for this fight?
Well, I did a few things different. For one, I work with much taller men. And I train for distance, in a sense.
Do you have a set plan in mind that you work on in training, or do you wait till you get in the ring and react to your opponent?
Well, if I need to look at films or watch anything in particular about a certain opponent, I will do. But for me, personally, I sum everything up in the ring.
Jerry Cooney was a slight 7-5 favorite. Did you have any doubts about your ability to beat him when you heard the match was made?
No. No, I just wanted to know how. That was my question. Now, how am I going to beat him? You know, I know of the way I would have to do it, but I mean how and which ways is it going to happen?
And it's fascinating that you would say that, Michael, because it was to be a bout which would showcase Michael Spinks' remarkable improvisational talent, his resourcefulness, his ability to adjust in the ring. And we'll be back to look at all 5 rounds of Spinks and Cooney after this.
Showdown is brought to go, a sold-out Atlantic City Convention Center with tickets ranging up to $500 tops. Scalpers lined up on the boardwalk outside and did business with a willing walk-up crowd. The assembled press corps brought full representation from both coasts. Liberal selection of celebrities dotted the crowd. Boxing champ Mike Tyson and Sugar Ray Leonard sat shoulder to shoulder. Legendary jockey Angel Cordero Jr. made the ride down from New York City. So did Donald Trump, financial backer of the fight. Up from Miami, Vinny Testaverde. So was Don Johnson. Arnold Lewis Cream, known as Jersey Joe Walcott, spent a lot of time in Spinks' camp. World Cruiserweight champ Evander Holyfield at ringside. The scene was set. Alex Wallow and I prepared to call the fight.
So to the music of Emerson, Lake, and Powell, Jerry Cooney enters. Jerry Cooney, a record of 28 wins and 1 loss, he is viewed as a paradox. Some see him as an awkward, unproven fighter who lost his one and only difficult match to Larry Holmes. Others call him a fighter of tremendous potential who might have been and may yet be a heavyweight champion. Which way do you see him, Alex?
Jimmy, could really be both of those things. I do think he's got tremendous potential, and if he can fulfill it at the age of 30 and beyond, he could still be a dominant heavyweight champion. The big key here is it's 5 years since Jerry got into the ring in the first big fight of his career against Larry.